morning. Welcome to Grace United Methodist Church. My name is Adam White. I am the associate minister here, and welcome. Welcome online. Welcome to those of you who are here. And we recognize today as Mother's Day, a day for many to celebrate, for some to mourn, for others. Mothers come in different forms or fashions, and we accept all of that as we come to this time of acknowledging maternalness and how God, in many ways, is a mother to us. We give thanks that Isabel DeCampo is here. Dr. DeCampo has been a member here for a while, a long time, she says, and she has so many gifts, and she brings her gift of word and voice, and we appreciate that. And she is an ordained minister in an American Baptist organization, denomination, which is a bit different than Southern Baptist since she's ordained. And yes, bad Baptist joke. So the last announcement we have is our dear Emily Clark, who's been our intern for, I counted, this is the 10th month. It's ridiculous. Yeah. She is going to be leaving us in terms of being on staff this next Sunday. And so while we mourn that and we celebrate the gifts that she has brought in so many different ways, we hope that you will join us here virtually, online, as we worship and offer a blessing. And she will have an opportunity to say goodbye in that space. But also, if you are available next Sunday from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m., we're going to do a little drive-through farewell where people can come in their cars, and if you want to get crafty, make signs, honk your horns, and voice your appreciation in whatever words you would like to share with Emily. Emily, again, we thank you for all that you've done, and we so look forward to being a part of your journey as you move along. Let us now turn our hearts and minds to worship. Thanks be to God.
Morning. Will you join me for our call to worship? It's a call and response. So I'll read the first line, and then all those who are here will read the second line together. Then all y'all who are watching this right now, I invite y'all to join us in reading that second line as well. Seeking peace in a broken world, but also knowing God's peace through God's presence, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Seeking peace in suffering, illness, and pain, but also feeling God's peace through healing, prayer, and those who help, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Seeking peace through our distress, depression, isolation, and fear, but also feeling God's peace through the words of loved ones and the hope we see in the world, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Seeking peace through the pain of worshiping separately, longing for our holy community to be gathering, but also feeling peace through God's presence with each of us as we worship together distantly, we pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, loving Lord. We need you now, as we have needed you every day. We cannot live without you. Amen.
With my mic. Hang in there with me. Thank you. We're going to read the scripture today that is found in John chapter 14. It's also a link for you on if you're following. And so before we read the scripture, I wanted to go ahead and tell you that the song and the postlude, if you can hang on and not leave and listen to the postlude, is the song that I chose for today. And I think you might enjoy it. It's by Pete Seeger. So just a little note on that. But let us read John 14, chapter 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the truth, the way, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So if you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. And Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. And Jesus said to him, have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still don't know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his work. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. But if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the great works that I do. And in fact, will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. In my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. Please pray with me. Open our hearts and minds to receive your word. Amen. Good morning, Grace, and thank you for bearing with me as I am, it's my first time doing something like this. But I'm very, very pleased to be here and very, very pleased to be with you in worship. And it's great to be here, and I'm pretending that I'm seeing all of you, dear ones, in all your different places. So it's really great to be here with you. The title I've chosen for the sermon is called You Know the Way. But I think most of us can attest to losing our way at some point in our lives. Sometimes it's because of something out of our control. Illness, the end of a relationship, death, or this pandemic. In each of these cases, we find ourselves filled with uncertainty, fear, and self-doubt. The frightening question we ask ourselves is, what is the way forward? And after 2 months of a shelter-in-place order due to COVID-19, the guidelines to re-engage are confusing since the deaths and cases keep rising. And until widespread testing is available, we carry the anxiety of being left on our own to decide how and when to re-engage safely. And so we're asking ourselves, what is the way forward from this experience? And what have we learned from it to help us? The comforting words I just read, let not your hearts be troubled, believe in God, believe also in me. Well, they help. They help to calm us so that we can start getting a little clarity. Jesus offered these comforting words to his closest friends, the women and the men who had traveled with him for 3 years. And they were together when he spoke them, hidden away, celebrating Passover. And they were hidden because Jesus was a fugitive from the authorities. His preaching of a divine love that breaks down all barriers and describing a world that was possible, not just a dream, had challenged the alliance between the Jewish leaders and the Roman Empire. So, of course, fear and uncertainty filled that room that night. And, you know, right before Jesus tells them not to worry, he reveals that he knows that Judas has already betrayed him to the Roman authorities. So now they have no doubt whatsoever that he is indeed in grave danger, and by association they are too. But I think it's also important to note that right after he talks about knowing about Jesus' betrayal, he pleads with them. He says to them, remember, as I have loved you, you also love one another. But as you know, it's hard to love people who betray us. But even so, Jesus is trying to remind them to show love. And when he does that, he's trying to redirect their hearts from vengeance to that of living more fully into the power of divine love that they have known with him. When he says to them, love one another as I have loved you, he is telling them, please keep yourself in solidarity with people from all walks of life like we've been doing. Keep holding the Jewish and Roman authorities accountable for their self-serving actions that has wrecked the lives of thousands of people with unnecessary suffering, but hold them accountable by showing them God's power of love as you do what they should be doing, as you look out for the well-being of others, especially the most vulnerable, with as much love and care as you look out for the well-being of yourself and of those who are close to you. Show them, like we have done for the last 3 years, the power of love that is found when we are living in solidarity together. Show them the peace of God that's available. That's what he tells them. It's also good to note that Jesus wasn't sugarcoating anything for them that evening. He knew it would be devastating. And in that last conversation over dinner, Jesus is passionately pouring his heart. But it is really hard for his friends to feel untroubled after all the full force of the religious and political state was coming down upon them. So when Jesus says, trust that I am one with God, and that where I am going, you will go too, for you know the way. Thomas, genuinely confused, asks, we don't know where you're going, so how do we know the way? It's hard to see clearly when you're in the middle of a crisis, and Thomas is in the thick of it. After all, they had worked with Jesus, seemed to be slipping away. So Jesus turned to Thomas and said something very profound. And we hear the response that he gives to Thomas with loaded religious interpretations from this side of history. But I'm going to ask you to try to hear it like Thomas heard it that night. Jesus says to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Thomas, everything I and we have been doing together is what the divine has asked us to do. What we've been doing is what is true, is what matters, is what connects us with God. It's what transforms us from within, and it's what's going to change the world. Just as truly as you know me, Thomas, you know God. So it's Philip interrupts and says, oh, Jesus, please show us God, for surely we need God to show up. I imagine Jesus looking around that room, frightened and confused faces, and I imagine that his heart just was swelling up with love for them. They were his dear friends. And he turned to them and he tried to find words to help them find clarity of mind and peace of heart. He was trying to help them to reconnect with those life-changing moments that they had shared together, when God had overcome their fears and had given them the courage to include women and lepers and Samaritans, and when they were feeding and healing. But still, they struggled with uncertainty, after all. If the divine is in Jesus and Jesus is in the divine, then why were the forces of evil winning that night? pain of betrayal, self-doubt, uncertainty, and fear is very, very real. It's the experience of free falling. I've experienced a free fall several times in my life. Once, when my life was upended by religious bigotry. Another, at the very near death of my three-year-old son. And more recently, in 2007, in a cancer diagnosis. I'm sure all of you here listening have experienced a free fall, one or two. When these come, just like this pandemic comes, it seems to come out of nowhere. And when they come, we are thoroughly displaced from the life that we are living and from our own self-understanding. Just as Thomas and Philip's lives were being totally displaced. Suddenly, superficiality is revealed, and we begin a much, much more earnest search for affirmation from our faith and from those close to us to help us truly define what matters in this finite life. We seek God very differently. In those moments, God comes to us and unexpected ways. For me, one of those ways that the power of divine love touching me, telling me I was not alone, came literally through the healing hands of a low-wage nurse's aide, a stranger, as she was gently washing all the dried blood from my body because my body had endured 2 days before a very grueling 5-hour surgery. Afterwards, as I just lay there refreshed, I was mouthing the words. I couldn't speak. I had a trach and I had another tube, a feeding tube, and I was mouthing the words, "Thank you." So she asked me if she could pray for me, and I nodded. And she prayed. She prayed in a foreign faith language, one that was not my faith language. And then she sang a hymn in a beautiful Caribbean accent. I was completely washed over with gratitude because, you know, her touch on my cut-up body felt like God's literal touch. Through her touch and her genuine concern for me that I heard in her prayer. Me a stranger, she a stranger to me, I a stranger to her. Those actions reconnect me with God so intimately in a moment of great physical and emotional pain. While there was still yet so much unknown for me at that moment, I felt beloved by God. Jesus is the way and the truth and the life, and Jesus' truth is how much God loves us all. And we can only come to know God's love in how we care and how we touch one another's lives. And we know that we have been touched by God's love when our hearts start overflowing with gratitude, and all we can say is thank you, thank you, thank you. While Jesus' truth is love, Jesus' way is to live in gratitude for one another's life stories and how God's love weaves us together through these stories. And until this pandemic, some folks would only define refugees and immigrants as burdens on our society and our economy. But now we see them as essential. Essential because they clean our hospitals and harvest and process our food. Their stories and their faces are now becoming our stories. And as we cherish these stories, we are discovering the power in the tenderness and vulnerability of divine love weaving us into one humanity. And I am truly grateful. But nevertheless, we have to return to the challenge of how are we supposed to forge the way forward in the midst of confusion, evil, and injustice. We have to admit that we sometimes feel beaten down, just like Jesus' closest friends were in this passage that we read. We feel powerless and futile like they did, and we are tempted to become a bit defeatist and to start saying things like, injustice is part of life, we have to learn to live with it. For example, we are overwhelmed and paralyzed at the pervasiveness of domestic violence and how it is emerging in this pandemic, at the increasing numbers of all kinds of shootings in our schools, in the McDonald's, in the Family Dollar store, and then the senseless shootings of black men, most recently Ahmaud, jogging in Georgia. And we are starting to reinforce a hopeless narrative that is spreading among our society that says, what can you do? Racism has always existed. Violence and violent people, they're just always part of society. And now I'm a little afraid that people will believe in the futility of medical science and of the help that social distance can give us, and that we will say stuff like, well, we have to accept that millions of people will die of this virus, and we just have to move on with our lives. This hopeless narrative is dangerous. It's dangerous because it tempts us to believe in evil. It's dangerous because it tempts us to believe that evil is a natural occurrence, and that it's more powerful than the power of God's love. Yes, without a doubt, suffering and inequities exist because the forces of evil do sometimes get the upper hand. But our Christian faith does not allow us to become comfortable with that, because that is a false narrative. My friends, we can end school shootings and other random shootings. We can work to end institutional and personal racism, and we can minimize the spread and subsequent needless death of this virus. The true narrative that God gives us is that a kinder life is possible. When we read, Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, it's to give us hope. Jesus' life is what gives us the power and courage to transcend and counter all evil. Our power is simply sharing the gift of love with what we have, and we have ourselves. And we can do only what we have the power to do, and that's enough. We must move forward in the belief that Jesus' life showed us that God's power of love is stronger than death. This is what I think Martin Luther King Jr. was meant when he said that he believed that the arc of life bends towards justice. And if we're going to speak of an arc, then that requires belief in a movement forward towards the real possibility of a kinder future. And only together, can we help one another not to lose sight of that. How we live today matters to how we will live tomorrow. This morning, as we find ourselves in isolation in our homes with a virus that has totally displaced the life that we were living just as recently as March 1st, wouldn't it be nice to have Jesus over and give us a word of encouragement? I think so. So I'm going to invite you to imagine with me that Jesus has invited us all to a Zoom call. So here we are, all at home, wearing whatever you're wearing, glued to our tablets or computers. And Jesus begins the call. We're all in this waiting room, and he lets us in. And he begins the call by just helping us to remember all those moments in this pandemic when we and others around us and those sisters and brothers all across the world have taken risks to do acts of kindness, not only to the sick, but to the frontline workers, to the people displaced from their jobs and needing food. He reminds us of all of that. And he's reminding us how God's presence and love in these moments have transcended the suffering and has shown us how goodness is still very much alive. Goodness is very much alive. But since Jesus can see our troubled faces, he goes on to say what we're thinking but not voicing. Jesus says, I know that you're troubled. I know that you're troubled because COVID-19 has done something else. COVID-19 has revealed an even bigger mess beyond the virus. It has revealed complexities of unequal power and deep hostility. And it has revealed who among us are suffering the most because of that. But because these messes have been made clear, Jesus goes on to say, you now have a clearer purpose of where you can witness to my love and where you can work towards justice. Remember, I've shown you the way. So you know the way through this. You know it. Immediately we start flailing and starting having all these gyrations and our faces get even more contorted. So Jesus, as a good Zoom meeting host, unmutes us so he can hear us. And we start talking all over one another and repeating those questions that Thomas and Philip had asked him. We really don't know the way. And we start laying out for Jesus all the different ways that we're feeling so unsure. Because we feel like the forces of evil are winning this night, just like Thomas and Philip. After we get it all out, Jesus mutes us kindly so he could talk to us. And he speaks to us with a heart full of emotion. He says, I know you are feeling anxious, but remember that I am in this mess with you. And after a pause, he goes on to say, my friends, if you can't trust that, then believe in all the good work that we've done together, reaching all people, not just our favorites. Let me remind you that my power is love, and that you have that power of love because I love you. I love you and all of creation. If you stay grounded in my love, you will survive any risk that you take when you move forward with acts of kindness for all persons. And you will recognize the power of my love in the human spirit's ability to transcend evil and to redirect the future towards love, mercy, and justice. My friends, trust, each one of you, trust that you are my beloved child. And let the transformative power of my love wash over you so that you can live with a posture of gratitude and joy. And when you do, you will do even greater things ahead. You got this. And right before he ends that Zoom meeting, he leans in and says, I'm counting on you. My friends, the power of divine love that is embodied in Jesus is the way. It is the truth. And it is life, and life abundant. Let not your hearts be troubled. For where Jesus go, you will go. And surely you and I and all of us together, surely we know the way. Amen.
Good morning. At this time, I invite all of you who are watching on Facebook to comment below with any prayer requests or concerns that you have you want us to lift up on this glorious Sunday. And I will be back up in a few minutes to go through that list and pray over them with you. Thank you.
We come to the time of our offerings, our gifts, and thanks to God. And we certainly give thanks to Dr. DeCampo and her words. Very prophetic. To be calm, to receive life, and to care for one another in such a crazy time. Thank you. This is an invitation for us to consider giving to Grace. If you have an opportunity, do so now or later. There is a donate button on our website. It's on the live stream page and on the top right corner of our home navigation menu. Your gifts go to support our ministries, the life of this church, and indeed how we seek to care for one another, to live into loving God and following God and trying to follow Christ's way in the world. Thank you.
Amen. When you pass through the flood, they will not weep. When you walk through the fire, you will not be consumed. You are my child. You are my child. You are so precious to me. You are my child, and I love you always. Just hold my hand, and I'll lead you home. When you feel lost, always remember, I am right here. Just call out my name. When you pass through the water, I will surround you. When you pass through the flood, they will not sleep. When you walk through the fire, you will not be consumed. You are my child. You are my child. You are so precious to me.
Let us pray. God, for the gifts that you have bestowed upon us, the earth in the way that it is breathing, the first responders, the frontline workers who are sacrificing themselves for life, those who are teaching, those who are encouraging and supporting one another at a distance, those who give, not just of their money, but their time, their resources, their love, in dynamic ways, we give you thanks. Help us to lean into one another and to follow you in your path, to your kingdom, to your grace, to your love. Amen.
Now we're going to take a moment to go through our community prayers. After I say each petition, we will say, Lord, or I'll say, Lord, and then you will say, hear our prayers. And when I've gone through the list from Facebook and from personal, what I've heard around here, I'm going to do a small reading for Mother's Day and lift up a prayer for all the mother figures that exist in our world today. So, first off, we'd like to pray for all those who are ill and or have undergone surgeries during this time. And we pray for speedy recovery and safety as they are more vulnerable to the virus. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray for all of those impacted by COVID and on the front lines, those who have had loss, those who are ill, and those who are facing overwhelm because their jobs are asking them to work harder than ever. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. We lift up those people that are transitioning back into the workforce as states begin to slowly reopen and people are asked to be out of their homes and face the risk of becoming ill. We pray that that transition treats them well and kindly, and that that transition just goes as smoothly as it can. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. And finally, I wanted to lift up other people that have graduated this month and are moving on into the adult workforce and navigating what that looks like with the economy as it is right now. So, in your mercy, Lord, hear our prayers. And now on to Mother's Day. Mothers come in all shapes and sizes. Today, we honor and lift up all the different kinds of relationships that daughters and sons have with the mother figures in their lives. We honor the sacrifices women around the world make daily in the name of motherhood. We lift up those grieving the loss of their mother and the mothers grieving the loss of their children. We lift up those women and men who have adopted and fostered and invited children into their lives, offering them that motherly love. We lift up those mothers and grandmothers who are helping take care of and nurture their extended family. We lift up those estranged and distanced mothers, recognizing their humanity and offering a prayer for healing and wholeness to them and to their relationships. We lift up single mothers and single fathers during this season. We lift up all mother figures all around the world and give thanks to God for being the divine mother to us all. Thank you so much, all moms and parents out there. I know that it's a weird season to be a parent, navigating children being at home and everything. So, heartfelt thank you for everything that you've done. Amen. Oh, yes. Okay, now we're going to go into birthdays and anniversary blessings. So I'll read through the names on our list, and we apologize if we've missed you. If we have, just know that you're in our hearts. So for the birthdays this week, we have Abby Morgan, Bonnie Brophy King, Chantal Irumba, Susan Lewis, Lance Ware, Faraha Faraha. Is it Denise or Dennis? Denise Strickland, sorry, I never know which one it is. Tom Boomerstein, Cherie Hartrick, Yvette Ninzunzi, and Eddie Young. And it looks like we don't have any anniversaries, so I'm just going to bless the birthdays and anniversaries together if we missed any. Will you bow your heads with me, please? Loving, loving God, we lift up all of those people who are celebrating birthdays, anniversaries, and joys this week. We know this is a weird season, and we can't celebrate in the ways that we might want. But we know that we are enveloped in your love, and we know how much joy and light each of these people brings to our congregation. So thank you for their lives, for their relationships, and for their witness. We lift them all up in your name. Amen.
Great, thank you.
Let us go forth grounded and in the confidence of the power of God's divine love, of being beloved, and being able to share it. Let us remember that it is through that love and that power that God is counting on me and counting on you to create a kinder world.